Welcome to the Introduction to KiCAD Workshop, taught by Scott Dixon. Scott, thank you very, 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 very much for doing this. Scott is a longtime Portland Area Robotics Society and tinkerer and electrical hobbyist polymath. Can I say that?
Yeah, sure.
And
saw a bad description.
Good. Saw the writing on the wall about KiCAD long before dorks like us saw it, has been working with KiCAD for a long time. In this workshop, we'll start with the schematic and do the board layout, and it'll just be an intro, and we'll go for a couple of hours until we all sort of run out of steam and Scott swears at us all. That's that. Scott, take it away.
Okay. So I'm going to give just a couple of quick minutes of introduction to KiCAD in the background for those who aren't familiar, and probably talk a minute or two about the differences between Eagle and KiCAD and moving between them, because I know there are a number of people who are doing that. And then we'll go through a little small project real quick, both, as Andrew said, schematic and board layout. And then I'm going to show you a completed project that was done by someone who has a YouTube channel. And the reason I'm doing that is for two reasons, really. One is it's sort of useful to see a little bit more complicated project and not have to go through all the work of getting to the final stages of that, because there are a few things that I want to talk about there. And also, he has a quick video going through the design of that board. So you can go back later and watch that and sort of refresh yourself on the steps. He goes through very quickly, but the flow should make some sense after you've gone through a simpler one. So that's sort of the layout. Hopefully that will cover, we'll be able to cover everything that will get you started. And then from there on, we can think about some of the fancier things that the newer KiCAD has brought in. So KiCAD has been going on for something like 20 years. It started out, I believe it was a university in France. It's certainly somewhere in France. I can't remember exactly anymore, but it was at the time a just sort of a combination of several different completely separate programs. There was a schematic capture program called EE Schema, and there was a board layout program called PCB New, and a few other tools, package for looking at Gerber files, and a PCB board calculator, and a few other bits and bobs. And for a long time, they were very separate programs, and you would move between them by starting up one and then doing some stuff, writing a file, starting up the other, reading that file back in. And the seams between board layout and schematic capture were very clear. That has, over time, become less and less apparent, to the point where with version 6, one of the big changes is that you no longer really see those seams anymore. It sort of all happens behind the scenes. You don't explicitly write files and read them back in. So it's a much more unified package. At least the programs still exist and you still run them individually, which you might want to do in some cases, but the typical flow is a much more unified one, and you really don't have to worry about those interfaces anymore. If you go back and look at older versions of KiCAD, especially older tutorials that you might see on YouTube, you will see a lot of those individual steps, which are no longer necessary. So one of the reasons I'm telling you this is because, especially with version 6, you really want to make sure you're looking at up-to-date tutorials if you're looking at things on the net, because things have changed. I think the old steps will still work. It's just that that's really not the way you need to do it anymore. In addition, as we were talking about earlier, version 6 brings a new file format. And it is not backwards compatible. So if you commit to writing your files out of version 6, You can't read them in the current stable version 5. You can go the other way. So anything that was written in the older versions of KiCAD can be read. Another really nice thing since I think version 5 probably is that KiCAD does a pretty good job now of directly importing Eagle files, entire Eagle projects. So board layout, schematics, even libraries. In fact, it can you can actually add Eagle libraries directly to the library manager in KiCAD and use them without even converting them. So they've done a lot of work in the last couple of versions to smooth the transition to Eagle from Eagle to KiCAD. But there are some differences, and one of them is that as opposed to Eagle, there has been a history, which is starting to disappear a little bit, but there's been a history of having two separate kinds of libraries. There are symbol libraries, which are libraries of schematic symbols, and there are footprint libraries, which are the pad layouts for board design. Those are separate libraries with separate kinds of formats, and that's somewhat different from the way that that Eagle does things. Also, that is one of the things that's beginning to disappear a bit as well. You can actually sort of put footprints or assign default footprints into the symbol libraries now. So again, that's something that used to be a very separate step where you would use one set of libraries and then use the other set of libraries and you wouldn't really mix the two. And those are starting to become a bit more seamless as well. So again, that's another thing you'll probably see differences in from the older versions if you go back and look at older workflows. I guess the other thing that I will say is that we're using the nightly because it's very close to the release of version 6. There have been a lot of new features that have been added that are really nice. In version 5, the big push was to improve the PCB layout flow. And so that had a huge overhaul in version 5. Version 6, they're coming back to the schematic capture and doing a similar sort of overhaul. So there's a lot of cleanup, a lot of unification, a lot of sort of smoothing out of the interface, the user interface, and making it very much more consistent between the parts of the program. So there's a lot of reasons for going with the version 6, even though at the moment it isn't the final release. And so the other thing to mention is that they're still fixing bugs. There are, as to my knowledge, essentially no new features that are going to go in from the nightlies to the final release. But you may run into the occasional bug. So if you are using it, it's a wise thing to turn on autosave, which it has as a feature. And so it will save your work every 5 minutes or whatever. I think it's actually on by default, but you might want to check it. And when you do make big changes to your boards, you might want to explicitly save things a bit more often just in case. Because every once in a while you will hit something. They're whittling away the bug list, and eventually once they get it down to a point where they're happy, they'll do the release. So they're not really setting a date. They're waiting until they get the big bugs out to provide it. So I'm gonna just turn off my video, I think, and scare my screen. Oops. I think you need to turn that on, Andrew, for me.
Oh, why does it keep doing that? I actually said
that's the that's the default.
Yeah, there you go.
Okay. Cool.
FreeCAD is needed for 3D object models. Sorry, I'm looking at the chat. I did not know that. That must be.
It isn't actually needed for it. Is one that they sort of favor, but because it's an open source tool. But no, it's not required. The 3D models are step files, and you can generate them. You can like download them from manufacturer sites most of the time. So you don't have to, in most cases, use a 3D CAD package to generate the 3D model. And I'm not really going to go into any of the 3D model generation in this course. So this is what you see when you start up KiCAD. It's a project manager page. Has all the tools, and you'll see in a minute the files that are part of the project show up here. So let's just do a new project. You can give it a name and you can put it somewhere. Let's put it where? Let's put it in working. And I don't know, call it test. So when you create a new project, it creates two empty files. The one that's with the KiCAD underscore PCB is obviously the PCB file, and the other one is the schematic, the SCH, this is schematic. And you can see the rest of the tools. So there's the PCB editor, there's the schematic editor, there's a symbol library editor for the schematic symbols, footprint editor for creating and editing board footprints, River Viewer. There's a tool for importing images if you want to put in logos or other kinds of things on your board. There's some calculator tools and a template generator if you want to have your own templates for the
Scott, boards. Do you mind being interrupted by questions?
Not at all.
I have a question. Maybe it's a dumb question. When I first installed this like a couple weeks ago, I noticed that there were some files that ended in .pro, but there were also files that ended in .kicad underscore pro. And I tried to open one of the kicad underscore pro files, and that was a mistake. do you know what those are?
I don't know why. Yeah, I don't know where they're coming from, because I think that's probably an error. Although it depends on where you're finding them. I mean, there are some template files and some example projects, which may still be in version 5 format. So that might be what you're seeing.
Right.
You notice there's a KiCAD Pro file here, which is the project file, which I created when I created a new project. So that's the new format for project files.
Right. I think that probably answers the question. It was probably an artifact of a migration from a version 5 file format.
Yeah.
All right. Thanks, Scott.
Yeah. All the new files should be of the format KiCAD underscore something, or KiCAD underscore something. Sorry. And the older ones will be of a different form. I forget what all they are, but So usually the first thing in the flow is you generate a schematic. So we'll just double click on the schematic editor and just make this big. So it generates a blank project page, basically, or a schematic page, I should say. And the layout of the tools is generally pretty similar from one to the other these days. So on the left-hand side, there are some sort of general settings and appearance settings kinds of things. Up at the top is a toolbar ribbon that has a lot of the things on for viewing, like zooming and zooming in, zooming out, and zooming to the extent of the project and things like that. And then towards the right-hand side of these ribbons, they usually have some tools which are specific to the thing that you're doing, for example, the schematic capture in this case. And they're sort of arranged in a logical left to right flow. So you, at least for some of them, you use them from left to right in the typical flow of things, but you don't have to. It's just sort of a way to help make it a little clearer. Most of these things are all replicated in the menus up above or at the top of your window, depending on what windowing system you're using. And then on the right-hand side, there's a bunch of more specific tools for, in this case, drawing schematics.
Scott, I promise not to interrupt all the time, but this seems like a good question to me, that this the schematic didn't come up empty. It's got that frame in it. Is that frame something from the library, or where is that coming from?
That is the default template for schematics. So you can generate your own if you like. This is what you get by default. So it has in it, if we zoom in, it has a title bar. And it's filled in a couple of the things like the version of KiCAD that you're using and the name of your project. And you can edit the rest of it. You notice that the default is an A4. You can change that if you like. So we could go over here to this tool, which is the schematic setup, and you can pick, you know, various, I don't usually change anything in these defaults, but that's where you find all of them. You can add and subtract things from that, the project field names and so on. As I say, I don't typically for schematics change any of that stuff. You can also set up the page size and things like that if you care to. Doesn't really matter. I mean, you might want to make it legal size or letter size if you're going to print it out, but other than that, it really doesn't affect anything. So in general, the human interface to KiCAD is sort of old-fashioned. It has a lot in common with CAD programs like AutoCAD and similar sorts of things, and much less in common with sort of modern Windows 10 or Mac kinds of UIs. And you just have to sort of accept that. And the sooner you sort of go with the flow, the better things will be. It's really intended to have one hand typing shortcuts that are commands, and the other hand running the mouse. And that tends to be the fastest, cleanest way to do it. You don't have to do it that way. You can select everything from menus. But really, if you want to get good at the at KiCAD, that's the way to do it. So if you look under help, you'll see a thing that says list hotkeys. And there are a number of them. You don't have to know them all, but you might want to find a few that are useful. And we'll talk about a few of them as we go along. But if you ever need to get a refresher on it, or you need to, if you want to change your or assign new ones, you can do it all here. So we can start by editing this if we want. So if we just sort of hover over this toolbar and hit the E key, E for edit, that's a common shortcut for editing objects throughout all of KiCAD. And you can see here, you can change the size of the page. So if you wanted to make it legal size, you could do that. And we can fill in the date and the revision, whatever else you wanted to fill in, the title and the company and so on and so forth. So you can change any of those things you want, and they'll get reflected in the contents of this title bar. That shows up if you print the page, but other than that, it really doesn't do anything except give people who are reading it information.
Yeah, by the way, I didn't know that, okay, we can use the E shortcut near on the description window.
Yeah, pretty much any object.
Okay, cool.
So let's start by adding some components. So there's a couple of ways to do it.
Can we talk about the grid for just a minute? That's something that screws up people all the time. How do you set the grid on this thing, and what's the default grid for a schematic?
You leave it alone is what I do.
We don't set it. It's
the you can set it, and if you want to set it, it's over here. So there's the grid tool, but
Else I think we can do right click and we get the grid tool. When we press right click and maybe it shows. I mean, if you are on that page, and I'm not sure. I mean, I use Windows, so.
Yeah, you don't really want to change it on the schematic capture.
Yeah, schematic.
Because all of the libraries are set with symbol. All of the symbol libraries are set really to work well with the default.
And grid. Can you tell me what the default is right now? So if you right click and go to grid, it's
25 mils.
Okay, it is. Okay. And can people who are running Windows, can you right click and confirm that the default grid is 20.025 inches or?
Yeah, sure. It's
50 thou on my fresh install. Same. So there's two there. The alternate grid is set to 25 thou.
I'll just confirm. I'll open it and.
Why is it showing that? Let's see what it says up here.
I think the default is 50 mil. I mean, even for me, it's like it's a fresh install. Like I just imported an Eagle file from one of the projects. So it's 1.25.
Oh, I wonder if because I changed to an A4, maybe that's what happened. Let's check that. So let's go back and change from A4. Let's check that.
The reason why is 50 thousandths of an inch is kind of default for
many. Yeah, that's what I thought it was going to be. Actually, I was a little surprised when it came up as not that.
And maybe sometimes even screw up, like when we accidentally press the end button. I think it changes the grid. I hope. I mean, that's a shortcut.
Yeah, let's go back to A4. Let's see. Mm-hmm. No, it's just on its. No, that's weird. Well, that's okay-ish because it's just a multiple of 50, but we'll set it to 50.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
I think that's probably what it's supposed to be. I don't know why mine's off.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, you shouldn't touch it generally.
Yeah.
Because the all the pins will be off grid on the symbols if you mess with it. And that's a bad thing. Okay, so, let's just talk about one other thing. So, if you go to manage symbol libraries, you'll see that the default libraries that come with KiCAD there's a whole bunch of them, and they are organized by function and sort of family and for electrical reasons. So these are all built in. They're the global libraries. You can make project specific libraries if you want. And those you would create, for example, somewhere in your own file system. There may be reasons to do that if you have a symbol that is not in the standard libraries. You can create it, and I'll briefly show how to do that. And you would put it in either a project-specific library, or you could have a shared global library that, for example, a group of people shared. So those are the two ways you can have sort of your own libraries. A lot of people tend to not trust any vendor libraries and make their own libraries. And so over time they build up a library that would be a global library for them, but not a default library that comes with KiCAD.
And do these default libraries, do they get updated? Is there some kind of like update system for this thing?
Yeah, there's a whole team of librarians that works on nothing but the libraries.
Yeah.
There's a GitHub.
DigiKey has one.
For all of these libraries, and they commit to that regularly. So yeah, it's a whole, essentially sort of a sub-project of KiCAD is the project librarians.
Great.
And it is possible to put in pull requests against those if you find errors.
Yeah, most of the time that I worked with the library, I mean, the default libraries, I didn't face major issues. Like, so far, I didn't have any issues. But yeah, maybe some weird IC might have some issues.
Yeah, I mean, there can be mistakes, definitely. But
Yeah, you're right.
Okay, so there's a couple of ways to add a component. The tool is over here, the third one down. Add a component, add a symbol. It's also the A key as a shortcut. So you get the same list of libraries that we just looked at. It will include any of your project-specific libraries if you've created any of those as well. And the way to deal with it, and you can do two things. One is you can poke around under, you know, comparators if you wanted to find a comparator you use, but most of the time that's sort of tedious. So you can just search. So we're going to do a search for HT753. So I'm gonna make a little voltage regulator circuit here. This is the regulator we'll use, and you see it's now attached to my cursor. And you can drop it down anywhere you like and zoom in. If you click again, you'll come back and you can add something else. Let's add a couple of capacitors. So to some extent, you just have to sort of learn what some of these things are. So C small is what I typically use as the symbol for capacitors. There's a normal C and then there's a C small. The C small just takes up a little less schematic space, so I tend to prefer that.
I believe they also have the US version for some
reason. Yeah, there's a US version, which is
there's not. There's no such thing as a US version. That's called a polarized capacitor, and they're wrong. So there you go.
Yeah, I stopped using those a long time ago. Okay, so we put down a couple of components and a couple of things to mention. First of all, let me go back to when it's attached. Whoops. So I'll hit escape to stop the add component mode, and I'm going to hit the M key. So when you're moving things around, there's a couple of useful things to know. One is if you hit the R key, it rotates 90 degrees each time you hit it. So if you want to, you know, while you're deciding where to place your component, you can also look at where it's going to be connected and decide to put it down somewhere. And when there's two ways to select things. You can click on something and then it highlights it and it's selected. Or in most cases, you can just sort of hover over. So while I have my cursor over this capacitor, I haven't clicked on it, so it's not highlighted. But if I hit the M key, it's going to go into move mode with whatever the component is. So this is one of those things which is very different from the normal modern UI paradigm of clicking to select and then operating on something.
Yeah.
You can do that if you want, but it's a little more efficient to just hover over something and hit the shortcut key.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
So if you hit escape, it cancels that operation, but you can also select it and you can right click on it and you can say move, and that works too. And if you're really hardcore Windows users, you can do it, but it's not the efficient way to do it. Okay.
No, we don't do that.
Couple other things. You notice that there are several, there's two fields for each of these symbols. One is a has a C or a U here, and then a question mark, and that's the reference designator. So, you know, on PC boards, you usually have reference marks on every component, something like R17 or C12, which identifies that component. They should be unique. They're required to be unique by the schematic capture program, but they start out unknown, and we'll come back to how those get assigned specific numbers in a minute. The other thing, so that's the reference. The other one is the value. And by default, it starts out as the component name. But if we hover over it and hit the E key, whoops, let's try undoing the, so we hover over it without something selected and we hit the E key, you can edit that. So typically what you do is you put the component value in there. So like 10 microfarads. For things like that. For things like this, which is an IC, the value stays as whatever the component is. So if I wanted to put down another capacitor, which I do, there's two ways to do it. You can go back and do add again. And if you do that, it will default to the last thing that you put in. So you can double click on it and add it that way. Or if I hit escape, it'll stop that. Or you can, another sort of useful way to do it is to duplicate something existing. It's just a fewer clicks. So the duplicate shortcut on Windows and Linux, I think, is Control D
Control C? Okay, let me try. I mean,
it's Control D.
Control D? Oh,
yes. Okay.
Yeah, let's just, yeah. On Mac, it's Command D. You can just hover over and do that and have another one real quick. It's a faster way to do it, especially if it's the same value. Okay, so we can put down a few more components. Let's say we want a diode for reverse polarity protection. So I think a BAT 5, it's a 5.4, I think it's a pretty common jelly bean one. 5.4W, there. And you notice that it'll show you what the symbol is in the, here. So that's sort of useful sometimes. So we'll use that. And we'll turn it around so that the electrons go the right direction. And let's go with that for the moment. Okay, so now we want to wire things up. So first thing we'll do is hit escape again to get out of the add mode. And then the command for drawing connections between components is W for wire. You notice that each of these pins, there's currently a little round circle, which means that it's not connected. If you start wiring things together, you'll see that when I click on the second connection point of that wire, the circles go away on both ends. And that means that I've made a connection to those. If I missed for some reason, let's say I was gonna do this connection and I double clicked and came up short. You see that there's little unconnected references or designators on both of those. So that's how you know that you didn't get it connected. Okay.
And by the way, can I add something? It's like it comes naturally to me. So I think if we hit the C icon when we are hovering over a certain component, we can copy that. We'll create a copy of that device in Windows. I'm not sure whether it's applicable in Mac as well.
Yeah, you can copy and paste. That's two strokes instead of one. So, I mean, yeah, that's another way to do it. Or you can right click on it and you can hit the copy and the context. There's lots of ways to do it.
Yeah.
I'm trying to go with sticking with the most efficient ones. So maybe we can just do that. And if people want to find the other alternatives, they can play around with it.
Yeah.
Hey Scott, your wire tool is making nice 90 degree bends and mine is not. Is there some way of telling KiCAD to do that?
I thought that was what it always did by default. Interesting. Is it? Yeah.
So on the left side of the screen there, there's a 90 degree miter. Or down one more. Bottom.
Yep,
one
that's
more.
It.
Oh, this one?
Yep.
Oh.
Yep.
Interesting. Do you not have that selected by default?
I apparently hit it by accident. That's really good to know.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that's another one of those things I never play with because I never want to.
right.
I never noticed that. Nice, Andrew.
Yeah.
Can I inject something here?
Yeah.
I fell behind because I didn't have any libraries, although I swear I did at one point. But anyway, so they were all there in the /libraries directory. So I did the... tools, was it preferences library manager, and it wanted me to add them one at a time, and so I couldn't do that because there's like 100. So it
you
turns
can
out,
select them all and add them. Yeah. I think
if you on my system anyway, if you press control, if you don't press control, you can't do that, which is the thing I wanted to inject anyway. Go ahead.
Oh yeah, control A will do it too. Mm-hmm. It'll select them all.
Tried that didn't work for some reason.
Really? No, it works on Mac.
Yeah, I don't know.
Sorry.
Yeah, it works on Windows FM. Yeah.
So I wired up the rest of this. Now we're going to add a couple more things, which are from this fourth window, fourth tool down, which is the power symbol menu. So power symbols are a separate library from all of the others. And you can grab a couple things here. So we want ground. So if I type GND, we'll find a ground symbol, and there's a bunch of different ones, but we'll take that one and we'll put it here. And we will get a 5 volt, and we'll put it here. And then we'll wire those up. And you probably notice if you're doing this that you get sort of one right angle bend for free when you're doing these wire tools. So if I'm, what I mean by that is if I, let's say I'm gonna, where can I grab it? Well, let me just delete a wire here or something. So the delete key deletes things. But so if I'm doing this, I get this one for free. If I want to make another bend, so I come back to this, I click here at this corner, and then that allows me to make another corner. So the first one is sort of free. You can just sort of pull in the direction you want it. It'll make a right angle. But if you want any more, then you just click on it to make the corner, to sort of freeze it at a point. Also undo works at any time, so you can always use the undo shortcut to go back and escape. I think I've said before, but just to be explicit, escape generally just terminates whatever command you're in and goes back to the default selection one. Okay, so got some stuff here. Let's put in one more power symbol. We'll do a 3v3. Where's 3v3? There's 3v3. Take that one and we'll put it over here because this is a 3-volt regulator. And we'll wire that. Okay. So now we've got a simple regulator circuit, 5 volts in, reverse polarity diode, a 3.3 volt LDO, and 3.3 volts out. if I hit E while I hover over this regulator symbol, you get all the properties, the reference, the value. In this case, this symbol has a default footprint assigned to it already by the librarians, and that's useful. It also has a link to a data sheet, which is pretty cool. So if you just type D while you're hovering over it, you'll notice that your browser fires up a link to the data sheet for that part. So that's really handy, and it's something you can do for yourself for any parts that you create, but you can also take advantage of all the work that the librarians have done to put in default links for all of these things.
Did you mean that like whenever we hover over any device, I mean any component, and we press D, it will take us to the data
sheet? If there's a data sheet link in, but yeah, probably not for the simple jelly beans like pastors and things like that. Yeah,
that is not working for me. Yeah, for some reason.
Huh. I think it depends on the component.
Yeah, it does. But it should work for this one, for example.
Yeah, I just copied your schematic and I use the same component, but it's not working.
Well, what happens if you do E on the over it and get the
E is when I press E, it shows the symbol properties, and then I can
is there a data sheet property?
Yeah it is there, and if I click on the icon, it shows the internet icon, then it takes me to the
It should work. D should work as the default for that. I don't know why it doesn't.
Yeah,
is it working probably for other people?
Yep.
Oh,
okay. Working for me.
It worked, but I had to deselect the previous component that was tricking me out.
Let's try again.
Yeah, you should, when you hover over something and hit the, you can't have something selected, because if I have this capacitor selected and then I hover over this and do D, it's not going to do anything because there's no data sheet for the capacitor.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to unselect. So that may well be what's tripping some people up. If you have something explicitly selected, then whatever you do refers to that. If you hit the shortcut key, it refers to that. So you have to unselect first by just sort of clicking in the background, and then the hover thing works.
Yeah.
So the other way you could do it is if you had it explicitly selected, the D key should work as well. Yeah, it does.
Okay, let's try that.
Okay. So
Scott, I'm still catching up a little bit. How do you drag things around? When I move things, they become disconnected from the nets.
Oh yeah.
So there's a couple ways to do it. One is if you do move, so if I move on this, it is going to disconnect it, right?
Yeah.
There's also a drag, which I think is G maybe. Yeah.
Okay, good. Thank you.
For schematics, it's not particularly useful because you still end up having to clean things up.
Yeah.
It does at least keep it connected if you want. So if I wanted to line these two up, for example, doing the G would be better than M. So that's another thing which actually, now that you mention it, Tim, we should talk about, is that there are some common shortcuts which will work pretty much across the board. M for move. G for drag, usually. There's R for rotate, which will work, you know, like that. The delete key will delete something.
Yes.
So those are all common shortcuts, and Control Z or Command Z, depending on what machine you're on. We'll undo and put it back. So those are all useful things to know.
And for the
OCD, and there are often some others. Yeah, go ahead.
Mm-hmm.
And for the OCD among us, X mirrors in the X axis and Y mirrors in the Y axis if you want to move the text around.
Yes, I always do use that.
Okay, so we're going to do one or two other things. We're going to add a connector. So let's do add. And let's search for CONN maybe. There's a bunch of them. You can sort of browse through and decide. I just want a 1x2 connector. I think there's some generic ones. Yeah, the generic connector library is the one I'm going to use. So 1x2.
I like those. I never use the small ones.
So we'll put in one of those over here. And I'm going to duplicate it. So Control D, and I'll put another one at the end here. And we'll hook up this one to, that's not what I meant to do. It's selected, so let's cancel that. Cancel out of that, and I'll duplicate the 3.3 volt. My duplicate. There we go. And I'll duplicate the 5 volt. Oops, come on. And I'll duplicate the ground twice. And you'll see why I'm doing this in a second. Then we'll wire them up. And I'm not being very careful about making these things look pretty, but it'll be fine. So I could have just run wires to these things and that would have been fine. The reason I didn't is really just to make a point, which is that nets that have names that have the same name are all connected implicitly rather than being connected explicitly. So everywhere that this 5+5V signal appears is the same thing. And they're all connected together. Similarly with ground. And you can also do that with other nets if you want. There's several labeling tools, which are here in the sort of the middle of the right-hand menu. There's one that says global names. There's one that says, let's start from the top. The first one is add a net name. Or net label, sorry. And then there's global label. And then there's one that has to do with hierarchical things. So we're not gonna talk about hierarchical schematics at all here, but just know that you can have multiple pages in the schematic for fancier schematics. And it allows you to hierarchically organize things. And that's really what the second and third tools are for. They apply across multiple pages of a schematic if you have hierarchical schematics. The top one is the one that you should generally use for giving nets names. So if you click on it, you can give a name, say, we'll call this name 5 volt. Oops. Volt. P. And now I have a little label, and you see it has a little square under it there, which if I place that square on a net, then that's labeling that net. And the square goes away to show that it's actually connected to a net. Now, that net, which is only this little piece right here, has the name 5VRP. A couple of reasons you might want to do that. One is, we'll see in a minute, it's sometimes very handy to have net labels show connectivity between sort of distant parts of a schematic rather than running explicit wires all over the schematic in long distances. And the other reason for doing this is that it also names that net when you're doing the board layout. And that's sometimes very nice to have. Otherwise it generates labels. And if you want to know where a particular net is and what its function is, having it named makes sense. So in this case, I've named it 5 volt RP for reverse protection. So I know that it's the 5 volt signal after the reverse protection diode.
Scott, I assume that the power symbols will name the appropriate nets when they're connected.
They do.
And when you, but when you just have a regular net that's not that, what's the default naming convention that KiCAD uses?
It generates a sort of a net name that has to do with the pads that they connect, the two endpoints. Mm-hmm. So you'll see it in some of the nets in the report layout. That's the most obvious place to see it. So there is sort of generated arbitrarily.
Scott, can I something like select or show highlight all the nets that say have 5 volts in their name or something like that?
Yeah, so you can do a search. A text search would be the best way to do that. But there's also the second tool down, which is highlight all the wires and pins of a net. So if you wanted to know where 5 volts was, for example, you see that it selected in one place and it highlighted in the other. This also cross probes into the PCB, by the way.
That is nice. And I have actually used that. Now that I see it, I remember using it. I did have
another
problem with
that. The other way you can do is you can search for the string 5V, for example, and find all of them. Oops.
Which is cool. And it finds them by highlighting them, right?
Yeah. Actually, it'll do more than just that. It'll highlight them, but it'll also, it'll go from one to the next.
Oh, okay. That's neat. That's neat. Mm. Okay, maybe that would do my thing. So the problem I had was I used the tool, they were disconnected nets, I highlighted it, but it was a schematic full of nets, and I couldn't find the other one.
Yeah, so then do the find, and it'll go from one to the other, okay, and sort of bounce between them for you.
All right, I got you.
Yeah. Let's see what else I wanted to mention here. Another thing which I'm not going to cover, but which is useful to know about, is you can have buses, which are collections of wires together, or connections to nets, which are bundled together into a single wire, basically. And one of the big changes in version 6 is that you can apply rules that tell the program and the rules checker what signals are allowed to be in a bus. So by sort of regular expressions, and that's sometimes very handy to be able, if you have a bus that has a collection of signals that are, you know, pin 1 through pin 16 or net 1 through net 16 or something like that, enforcing that behavior on the bus is sort of a nice thing when you're doing fancier stuff. So just know it's there, but we won't talk about it for now. Just double check if I've forgot anything else here. No, it doesn't look like it. One other thing to mention is that there's an interface to the SPICE family of simulators, circuit simulators, from the schematic capture in version 6, I think maybe in version 5 as well. So you can actually generate the input to a SPICE simulation directly from this schematic that you've drawn.
I've always wondered how to do that. I never tried that before.
Yeah. And there are simulation models built into the libraries for some components. So it can get you started. Okay, let's talk about one other thing before we move on. So there's a tool here to create symbols. Excuse me, one second. So if there's a symbol that you need that isn't in the libraries, this is the tool that you can do use to create it. And the first thing you need to do is to select a library. So this is one thing that trips people up a little bit, is that you want to create a symbol, but before you can create a symbol, you have to tell what library it's going to be in. Now, typically, you wouldn't want to put it into one of the global libraries because when they get updated, that would get lost. So you'd probably put it in a local library. So you do a new library, and you would say it's a project library, and then it's going to say, what do you want to call it? And we'll call it Proj. Or whatever you want to call it, except I'm having to type in on my new keyboard, which I'm not used to. So that puts it in the same folder as the rest of the files in the project. And then you create a new symbol with this tool here. And you'd give it a name, which is, you know, whatever it happens to be. Typically the component name or, you know, component ID, whatever. You'd select a reference designator letter. So if it's a IC, you'd use U. If it's a different kind of resistor, you'd use R and all, so the normal sorts of conventions. Most of the rest of this stuff is for packages that have multiple pieces to them. So sometimes you want to have multiple symbols or multiple parts to the same symbol. The most common thing is for packages that have like hex inverters or something like that. So you'd say that it was, there would be six units in that, and they're all the same, or they might not be all the same, in which case you would answer these questions differently. But for now, we'll not worry about that. It is something to know if you need to do it though. So we'll call it test, and it by default sort of puts the text all on top of one another. So there's the reference designator. If I hover over it and hit M, I can move the name and the reference designator out of the way. And we'll just do a real quick thing. There's a set of drawing tools here. So you might want to draw the square. And again, we're using the default grid, so that the pins will come out on the same grid. Shrink that a little bit. And I'm gonna go through the whole thing, but we'll make it centered. And then you put in pins. So this is the tool for that. And I click somewhere. And you can give a pin name. So let's say SCL. And you give a pin number, say one. You can assign a type to it. It's an input, an output, bidirectional, tri-state, all sorts of things, power input, output.
What's I suppose the pin number is on the package. So if you wanted to add package information, you could do it here. Okay.
Yeah.
Yes. So the way that pins are associated between symbols and footprints is by the pin numbers. Once in a while, that is a problem because occasionally there are, you know, there are packages which depending or there are components with different symbols on different numbered pins depending on the package. So that's a case where the separation between package and footprint breaks down just because of the way things are made.
Sometimes you have to manually go to the footprint and edit the label.
Yeah, so the pin numbers, you just have to make sure that those line up with the footprint. Most of the time this works fine, but that's what that's for.
Yep, okay.
And then there's a right and left and up and down, which just depends on where on the package you're going to, where on this symbol you're going to put it. I'll show you in a second what that does. So we'll take one and we'll put it here. And the way you do it is like this, because remember this little circle is where you do the connection. And so the pin labels are inside the package. The numbers are on the pin. And this function shows up now, but doesn't show up when you're using it. That's just whether it's input, output, or power, or whatever, right? So if you do it again, and you want to put the symbol on the other side, then you do left and fill this in with a SDA and pin number two, let's say. And then we put this one over here, for example.
Although for the record, the rotate and move and everything else like that works too.
Yes. Yeah, it does. Yeah, so you can always change it. Okay. And edit things as you choose. But what you typically do is sort of go down one side and down the other side. And so they're all the same for one side and another. There is another way, which is sometimes a lot easier, which is this pin table. That gives you a tabular display of all the pins, and you can edit all the properties here. So it's sometimes a lot easier to do it just by going and filling this out. If you need to make corrections to the pin numbers, for example, it's typically a lot easier to do it here, or if you want to change these things.
Huh, that's cool.
So that's sort of, that's sort of useful.
Yeah, that's nice. Nice that you pointed that out. I didn't use those features.
and
yeah, that's go ahead.
Sorry, Scott. In EC411 people, if you go back to the pin table, don't forget to set the input and power input and the electrical type of the pin so that the ERC, the electrical rule check, will do the right thing.
Yeah, right. That's the main purpose.
We'll come up to that in a second because we do that. Okay, so then you can save that symbol to your library and use it, which I'm not gonna do. Well, maybe I will, I'll save it. It's sort of a silly symbol, but whatever. So then if I did add and look for test, I'll probably find a bunch of other things, but test is in there in my project library and I can use it just like any other symbol. Okay, so that's the general way that you can add new symbols if you need to.
Scott, is any of this library stuff scriptable at all?
I not at the moment, and the reason for that is that the Python API for the schematic capture program has not been published yet. That's one of the last, in fact, I think it's the last major feature for version 6 that hasn't come out yet.
Okay.
Footprints, yes, because the footprint, the PCB layout program has had a Python interface for a long time. And so there are wizards that people have generated for generating footprints for things like BGA packages and things like that, where there's a lot of repetitive busy work. And those are all just Python scripted.
Cool.
And I expect that there will be things like that once the Python API for the schematic capture comes out. There are other packages which will do some of this symbol generation stuff in sort of external packages and just generate the files, but it'll probably be built in as wizards pretty soon after that Python API comes out. Okay, so we've got our schematic here. And if we go along here, we've looked at the footprint editor. The next tool in the line here in these is the symbol reference designators. So there's a couple ways you can do this. You can do it by hand. So if there are particular things which you want to have particular designators, you can just hover over the reference designator and fill out whatever number you want. So if I want that to be U1, no matter what, I'll just make it U1. And that's perfectly fine. Or you can edit it in here, same thing. Just a couple of other things while we're looking at the edit symbol dialogue here. You can change symbols by using this tool or this part of the dialogue. And that allows you to, for example, If you wanted to go through and change all of those C smalls to C, to big C symbols, you could do it by using this tool here, and you just say change all the symbols which match this library identifier, and then I could pick a different one from the libraries, and it would change them all, for example. So if there's a sort of mass changes you want to make, this is a nice way to do it, to replace symbols with different ones. You can also update if the library is updated. You can also actually just edit a single instance of a symbol by editing the symbol. And then I can make change to the symbol, save it, and it'll actually only change that version of it in the schematic and not in the library.
That's neat.
Which is sometimes neat, sometimes dangerous, but it's something you can do. Or you can go directly to edit the symbol library, which is another choice there. So those are all useful things to know.
And Scott, if I update the library, if I make a new library and then I make a change to it and make another change, do I have to hit edit and then do update library? It won't just automatically update?
I believe it does not.
Okay.
It's been a while since I've tried that, but I believe it does not. And the reason it does not, and something I should mention, is that in version 6, even if you don't have the libraries, and we'll see this later in an example, the symbols are all stored with the schematic.
Yeah.
So the schematics are self-contained in version 6, which means that even if somebody used a library that you don't have access to, you still can use the schematic.
Yeah.
And similarly with the footprints.
Yeah, that's nice.
So for that reason, I'm pretty sure that they don't automatically update from new libraries, because it might be a library that you didn't want to have updated. Or a symbol you didn't want to have updated, some other library's version, right?
And I did check in, and the edit thing does give you the option of updating that specific symbol, I believe.
Yes. Yes, you can edit. You can update that symbol. Update the one in the schematic only, or you can actually update the one in the library. Those are two choices you have. You can edit the library symbol as well.
The feature that you showed right now with the edit window, is it part of version 6? Because I'm not getting that in version 5.1, I mean, 5.1, the latest one, 5.9.1, whatever.
I can't say. We're not talking about version 5 at all. So.
Oh, okay, cool. Yeah, because I had some issues importing KiCAD file, I mean, sorry, Eagle files into version 6. So I moved back one version to import it.
I don't know. I've had better luck with 6 than 5. They've improved the importer, but if you
was like
that works fine. I mean, you would then generate a version 5 KiCAD project and then
import it in version 6. Yeah,
that'd work fine.
Yeah, that's the plan right now.
I haven't had that trouble. I've actually had better luck with 6 than 5 because they've done a lot of work on the importer.
Yeah, I mean, it's not the importer. What happened was, like, I was getting some graphic issues with the layout editor. I was getting a lot of green lines. I don't know why.
I had a very bad problem going from 5 to 6, also actually involving the libraries. And I didn't go back to 5, but I had to, like, basically destroy the libraries that 6 was seeing and then reinitialize them to get it to work.
You have to be careful with having multiple versions around, because there are environment variables that point to different ones, and if they're not correct, or if you know you have the wrong version of the libraries in where the version 5 and where version 6 should be, you can get some really bizarre behaviors. So it's a little, you have to be a little careful about having the two versions around at the same time.
I'm not sure because you have to make sure
that everything's pointed in the right spots.
I didn't do it twice, so I'm not sure, but I think my flaw was that I installed 6 and the first thing I did was edit something that was a 5. And so I simultaneously triggered the hey, let's get all the libraries set up with the, oh, hey, let's import all the libraries or fix all the libraries from the SPI version thing. And I don't mm-hmm. think that, at least on the version that I had, that doesn't actually work.
Hmm. Okay. Yeah, I don't know. I haven't had trouble like that, but I can
see
where.
That's because you're doing it right, Scott.
Yeah, I don't know. Yeah. I just haven't played with version 5 for a while. I shouldn't say that. I do have it around. I just make sure that the pointers to the libraries and all the auxiliary files are separate between the two, so they don't get mixed up. And that seems to be okay.
Mm-hmm. And I'd have worked with version 6, but it was like around 6 or 7 months back. I didn't have any issues, but it's relatively new. Like I pulled the new nightly build, like, I don't know, from 3 weeks back or something. And that was the one that was causing some issue.
Mm, yeah. Once in a while, it's going to happen that they introduce new bugs while they're fixing old ones.
Yeah.
So let's see, where were we? Oh, okay. So you need to assign reference designators uniquely to everything that needs one. So you can do it by hand. By editing the files. I'm sorry, by editing the symbols. Or you can use this tool, which is this one right here. And it will automatically generate unique reference designators for everything that hasn't already had a reference designator. So it asks you what you want to apply to the whole schematic or only the current sheet or only a selection that you've previously made. And then you can have a couple of different patterns of how you generate them. So it either generates them by starting with one and going down the page, 2, 3, 4, 5, or starting with one on the left and increasing the numbers as you go to the right. So those are the two choices. I usually just leave it to the default. You can either keep the existing annotations, like if I wanted to keep this U1 that I mentioned, then I would make sure that this was clicked here. And you can tell it where to start the numbering. So you might, some cases you might want to start the numbering from 100 if you use some particular numbering scheme for different parts of your schematic or something like that. But simple cases, you don't bother with any of that. Just leave it all defaults and you do annotate and it tells you what it did, which is supply the annotations to all of these and then you close. And now you see that everything has a unique reference designator. And then the next thing is you want to do the ERC check that Andrew mentioned. So we'll do that. You open up the window and you do run DRC. And it gives you a couple of warnings, which you almost inevitably get. These are related to the power input output types of the pins. And they're harmless. I typically ignore them because it just comes from the fact that people have not been particularly particularly careful and particularly consistent in how they use the power input and power output pin types in symbols. Mm-hmm. So there's a couple of ways you can treat this. You can take my view and just ignore them by doing a click and say, ignore all the type of warning, and then it won't bother you anymore. Or you can use what's called the power flag, which basically says, this is where power is coming from. These are all complaining because, let's look at this one, for example. If we look at the symbol, so let's edit the symbol. It says that power and ground, the VN and ground are both power inputs. And so it's expecting those to both be driven signals from somewhere else.
Oh,
okay. And they're not necessarily. for example, the 5 volt here, if we look at that, that's also input. So people haven't really been very careful about that. So if you want to, correct it, you add an additional flag in the power symbols. You look for power flag, and you can add that to, for example, this 5 volt net. This 5 volt net. And then we can duplicate it and we can add it over here to ground. And that'll probably fix the problem. That just says that these nets are sources of power. So now if we run the check again, I think that'll probably fix them all. Oh, actually I'd have to annotate because we added a couple more components. Let's annotate. Now run DRC. Well, there's one more. Oh, okay. So there's one more, which is this one, which is a different net name. So I'd have to add a power flag to that one too. So that's the way you can do it if you really want to be OCD about it and fix them all, or you can just ignore those, whichever you prefer.
Scott, I might have missed it, but Eagle has the concept of approving a specific error.
Can do that. Okay. Yeah, you can do that too. You can either ignore them or you can say they're okay. Let's go back and we'll look at that. So there's one left, I think. So when you right click on it, you can exclude this violation. You can change the severity if you want, or you can ignore it. Exclude is basically saying I'm okay with that one. Don't show it to me again.
Great, thanks.
Yeah. And it'll leave these markers up, and you can always click on any of these markers to see what they are. Or you can exclude them if you want as well. But down at the bottom here, you see it tells you what that marker is telling you. So you can just sort of see them from that. It'll leave them there if you want to get rid of them, you can just delete the markers and then close, and then they'll all be gone. Okay, so I think that's it for schematic capture. Any other questions that we haven't covered already?
I think maybe it would be nice if we can cover, we can change, did we cover that? I'm not sure, changing the properties of components in the component editor, there's some tool, something like that, right?
Not sure exactly what you're
But 10 microfarads, you mean?
You mean that? Yeah, we did cover that.
Oh yeah, okay, cool.
Yeah. So you can edit the value and just change it to whatever you want.
Oh yeah. Oh, I was thinking about footprint assignment tool. It's handy to use that in order to assign footprints to different.
Yeah, that's sort of the next step.
Oh yeah. Okay, cool.
We're talking about schematic capture at this point. That's PCB layout.
Okay. Yeah, cool. Yeah.
Any other questions about the PCB layout tool, the schematic capture?
No, this is great. I suggest let's take one more step. Let's get it to the PCB and then let's take a 5-minute break.
Okay, so we've done the DRC, we've annotated it. So the next thing in the flow is to actually look at the footprint assignments. So this is where you decide what the footprints are for each component. So some of them have already been assigned, as we said before. This one and the diode and the regulator. There's two capacitors. And on the left-hand side here are all the libraries, the footprint libraries. And in the middle is the list of all the components in your schematic. And on the right-hand side are various candidate footprints. Up at the top, there are three check boxes, or sort of click boxes for different filters And by default, I think they're all on. So one of them is filter by terms that are in the symbol. So the symbol might have a tag of capacitor, for example, or something like that. So you notice that when I'm clicking on this one here, the C1, the first capacitor, it's only showing me capacitors, and that's because there's that keyword in the symbol, and so it's used that to filter the libraries. And then it'll also only show you things based on the right number of pins, and you can also filter things by specific libraries. So if I clicked on a particular library, like let's say I only wanted SMD capacitors, so I could click on this, and that would then take out any through-hole ones which might be in here. Now the list is shorter and it's all SMD. So that's how you can sort of narrow things down to find the footprint you want. So now I want to make these SMBs, so it makes sense for me to click on that. And now I choose a particular footprint size or footprint type. And the naming, they've been switching the all of the library footprint names to use one of the standards, JDAC maybe, or IPC. I think it's actually IPC standards. So these are all very sort of formulaic. They have the type of the thing. Then they have the component size in two different flavors for things like capacitors. The first one is the imperial size, so 805. And then the second one, past the underscore here, is actually the metric one. So you have to be a little bit careful because sometimes there's an 0805 that's metric and an 0805 that's imperial, and the two are not the same size at all. So you have to be a little careful in selecting the one you want. So I want an 805 for this, let's say. And then there's two different flavors of 0805s. There's one that's just a normal one, and then there's one that says hand solder. And if you're going to be assembling your boards by hand, then you want to use the hand solder footprints. And the reason for that is it gives you a little bit of extra tails on the end of every pad so that you can have a place to get your iron on it. If you're doing, pick and place assembly, then you'd use the others. So I'm going to just double click on this one, and it's going to assign, and I did it twice, so it assigned it to those two. Then I want to assign a connector, so I don't want this selected anymore, so I'll control unselected. Stop. I don't know how to do that. I'll turn off that. So now I want connectors, and I want I happen to know that I want pin headers. So I want pin headers in 2.54 millimeter spacing. And if you don't know what you're getting, you can actually look at use this tool here, I think it is. Yeah, view the selected footprint. So if I wanted to see what this one was, can actually view it, and it'll pop up a little display of that, and it'll actually even show you the 3D rendering of it if it has one. So there's what it looks like in 3D.
That's obvious.
So you can sort of figure out whether you really want that one or not. I don't actually want this one because it's an SMD one. And I want the through-hole one, so I want this vertical one. So I'll assign that to that and to that. One more time. And now I've assigned the footprints to the footprints to everything. And I just do apply, say schematic and continue, and then okay. And now we're ready to go on to the PCB. There's a couple of other tools you can do here, which like generate a BOM, a bill of materials for your schematic, which you might want to do just so you can order the parts, things like that. But that's the last thing we have to do before we go to the board of design.
Scott, a quick question. I've diverged a little bit because I was behind it, and so my schematic doesn't really look anything like your schematic, but I did do the thing with the 3D view, and it showed the footprint in 3D on a board, but there was no component. Is that just because it didn't have one, or does that mean something mm-hmm. special?
Yeah, it might no. have a pretty...
Okay.
Depending on which footprint you chose, yeah. If you chose that 2.54 pin header, then it does have one. I happen to know why I chose it.
Thank you.
But yeah, but not all the others will. Some do, but not all.
Scott, what I meant was like previously, the edit symbol fields, there is a tool for editing the symbols in a column, in row column fashion. And sometimes if you have a lot of components that we may have to change, that comes in handy. That I find that comes in handy. That's what I meant. Like that's next to the BOM, like left to the BOM.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, right. That's another place you can do mass edits. You can also do it. There's a couple of other tools where you can use to do mass edits as well. But yeah, mm-hmm. no, that's a good one to point out. Depending on what kind of changes you want to make. Okay, anything else?
Cool. Make a board.
Okay, so we click on the tool that says, well, actually, let me do a save just in case. I think it already did, but we'll click on the Open PCB. And it opens a blank screen again. And again, this is the same as the schematic editor. It has the title block again, where all the information carries over. And it's just a blank page. So the first thing you want to do is bring over all the information from the schematic. So in tools, there's actually a couple places you can find it, but one is in tools. It says, update PCB from schematic. And so you can hit that and it will give you this dialogue and it'll tell you what it's about to do. So it's going to bring over all the symbols and all the footprints and all the connections that we've made from the schematic. And it's going to put them on the board. You can have it do a couple of other things which you may or may not want to do. Usually the default is fine, which is to replace the footprints with anything that you've changed in the schematic. So if you change the footprint assignment in the schematic, you would want it to do that. And that's what it does by default. Sometimes you may want it to delete footprints that aren't being used anymore. So you might want to use that option as well. But and then you want it to relink based on the reference designators. So. Typically you use the defaults, but sometimes you might want to do something additional. So it tells you ahead of time what it's going to do. And then you can say, do it by saying update PCB and then close. Now what you get is basically all of the schematic information smushed together. So this is all the footprints and all of the netlist, rat's nest. And all you do at this point is plop it down. And if we zoom in, you'll see that it's all there. It's just all in some totally random order.
All right, that's awesome. I'm gonna suggest that we take a 5-minute break and come back in 5 minutes and then let's lay out a board.
Yeah, all right. I have a quick question, like it won't take much time. It's like in version 5, I always used to generate the netlist. We don't have to do it here.
No.
Oh, okay.
No, you may have come in a little late. That we talked about that right at the start, that those explicit steps are no longer necessary.
That's
all hidden in it. And you can move the changes by using this tool here. You can update the PCB from the schematic. So anytime you make a change to the schematic, you can use that. You can do the same thing in reverse. So if you make changes in the PCB, you can also go in the other direction.
That's a nice feature. Yeah. I'll see whether if I can get the project up and running in version 6. Last time when I tried it didn't, so I'll try again one more time.
Yeah, should work. Okay. All right, 5 minutes. Talk to you then.
Yep, come back at 8:40. I'm gonna leave the recording going though, just so we don't have two different files. So if you're listening to the recording, you should fast forward 5 minutes.
Can we pause it?
Oh, can we? Actually,
I don't know.
I mean, oh, look, I can pause it. Okay, never mind. I take it all back. All right, let's do this.
Okay, so we left off with this mass of components. It's not very many in this board because it's very simple, but typically you might have a large number of components that are all randomly placed. And the first thing you need to do is place them all on the board. So it's one of the most important parts of laying out a board is figuring out the right place for all the components. That can make a difference between making easy routing and a hard routing. So what I usually do is I usually run two screens and I have the schematic on one and the layout on the other. I'm doing it with just two halves of the same screen here, so it's a little bit more crowded, but I want to show you a couple of little tricks. First of all, this is the layout thing. It's laid out in a very similar way to the same sort of layout. There's a bunch of sort of appearance and setting things on the left-hand side. There's a bunch of tools on the right-hand side, and there are the general things, again, the strip above. There's some additional things here. So typically when you fire it up, it has this menu of all of the layers in the board. And then there's another menu of different kinds of objects, and you can turn things on and off here. And we'll do that in a second. And then there's a listing of all the nets in the board. So I'm gonna actually hide this for the moment, and that's done with this button on the lower left-hand side. So that just gives us a little more space right now while we're cramped. And just like with the schematic, the first thing you would want to do is to set up the overall board layout properties. So that's this tool here. And that gives you a sort of a tabular view of the stack up. So first of all, we'll take the second one, and that's the physical stack up. We're going to make a two-layer board, but if I was going to make a four-layer board, or six or eight or whatever, this is where I would choose that. And then if you want, it doesn't really matter for anything we're going to do right now, but you could actually put in the physical stack up parameters that the fab house would use, the layer thicknesses and copper thicknesses and colors of the silk screen and the solder basket and all that stuff if you wanted. And then you see these two layers here. There's the front copper, the top copper, and it's a signal plane. There's the bottom copper, and it'll be, we could make it a power plane if we want, but or mixed or whatever, but it doesn't really matter. Again, it's just sort of informational at this point. A few other things that you can set. I usually leave most things alone, but there are, you might want to add some widths, some additional track widths. The default one, if we look under net classes, the default one is a 0.2 millimeter clearance and a 0.25 millimeter track width. And if you wanted, you could set some more. So you could say, there we go. So you could add some track widths here if you wanted. So you could add a, you know, 0.4 and a 0.5. 5 and maybe a 1 or something, whatever you want. This just gives you some additional width you can use while you're routing. Same thing with differential pairs if you're using those, and vias if you want to set your via sizes. There's another thing here, which is net classes, which starts out with just one default net class, which has the default width and clearance and so on, via sizes. You can define more of those. So let's say you wanted to have a power net class, which had wider traces and maybe, you know, a different clearance rule or something. You could do that by creating a new one here, assigning the parameters you wanted, and then assigning different nets to that. So it might, if you wanted to do that, you could assign, say, the various power rails here to that. That's sometimes that's useful. And then there's something you can do, a bunch of fancy custom rules for checking the checks.
Yeah.
Hey Scott, oftentimes you can import these rules from a file. Is that possible here? Yes,
it is. Yeah, it is.
Yeah, it is.
One of the other big changes from version 6 is a much more sophisticated DRC, including a much fancier language for describing rules. So I haven't really looked at that yet, but you can have those rules in a file and import them. And they can be quite a bit more sophisticated than they used to be.
Great, thank you.
Yep.
Scott, how about the schematic to board consistency? How do you do that?
In what sense, Tim?
Well, so
in Eagle guys will have that issue all the time. Oh my God, I've had so much trouble with that.
Well, so what I'm saying is that if the schematic changes, how is that change reflected in the board? Or if the board has an element that's not consistent with the schematic, how would you discover that?
So that's two questions. The first one is that you use the tool to import update PCB from schematic. Mm-hmm. Anytime you've changed the schematic and you want to update the board, it doesn't happen automatically. So you choose to do it when the time is right.
Uh-huh, okay.
Okay, and so you use that anytime the schematic's changed and you want to reflect that in the PCB. The second question is, how do you know that they're not in sync? And that's part of the DRC. You can actually select an option that says check the consistency between the schematic and the PCB.
Ah, I see.
Mm.
And it'll actually show you that.
Yeah, that's cool. I didn't know that. That's nice.
It's a new feature in version 6.
Oh, really?
It's your DRC checker.
Okay, yeah.
So I usually, as I say, have these both of these at the same time, one on each screen. And the reason for that is that you can cross probe between them. So if I select actually I'm going to change one thing. So in preferences, let me go to preferences. I want to, okay, I'm going to go back to defaults. Okay. So if I select something, the default is that if I select something in the PCB editor, the default is that it pans and zooms the schematic to that component and shows it to me highlighted. So you see how it moves around the schematic depending on what I've selected. And similarly, it goes the other direction too. It does it for nets as well, although it's a little harder to see with when you have just rat's nests. And so when you have a lot of components and you want to sort of group them logically, and find them in this maze of parts. It's useful to highlight them on the schematic, which then allows you to find it and move it. So then if I come back, click on this window and just move this component, I can put it where I want it. With a small number of components like this, it doesn't really matter, but if you're doing a lot of them, it does. So that's what I typically do. I'll have one window with the schematic where I can select the things that I want. So I might take this whole section and take each one of these and put them together in the section of the board because they're logically related. And so I want to pull them all together on the board placement. So usually what I do is to do some sort of a rough board outline just to give me some boundary. So if I go back and turn on the layers, the board outline is in the edge cuts layer here. So you select the edge cuts layer, and then you select one of these drawing tools like the rectangle, and I'll just make a rectangle of some shape. And it shows you the size there, as you see. It doesn't really matter. This is just give me some boundary. And the other thing that I do is that in the preferences, I will turn off, under the PCB editor, I'll turn off the zoom to fit cross probe item. The reason for that is if I'm trying to move things into a particular spot on the board, I don't want it to always be zooming in and out and changing my viewpoint as I probe on these. So I didn't want it to do that. I thought I stopped that. I don't want that either. So I just wanted to keep the viewpoint. Yeah. So now when I select things, it'll select them, but it won't move the viewpoint, which is useful.
Yeah, it is.
So I'll select that and I'll come back over here and I'll move, I'll move that. Select that. Let's do that again. Come on. I'll put that there, and I'll grab this, and I'll move, wrong thing, I need to go back to this window, and move that, and I might want to rotate that, and again, same thing, it's the R key, same as before, I'll put it somewhere useful.
Maybe I missed this, but my components seem to be snapping to the grid kind of annoyingly. Is there an option that I need to click off so that it doesn't snap to grid while I'm in the PCB?
No, you probably want it to snap to grid, but you might want to have a smaller grid. So,
okay.
As opposed to the schematic, the PCB editor, you often change grid sizes. You don't necessarily want to use the default grid. It just depends. When you're placing things, you typically want to sort of a coarse grid just because you want things to sort of neatly align with one another. And then when you get to routing, you probably will use a smaller grid. So if it's annoying you, you can turn it off somewhere, I forget where. I don't usually, but I might change the grid size to a smaller one.
Yeah, that's really helpful. I think it had me set it like 5 millimeter grid size. So it was pretty ridiculous.
Oh yeah, that's a big size.
Yeah. So we just continue that way and grab the other things and put them in logical spots. And flip them around. So that one actually, where would we put that? We'll put that over here. And while you're doing it, you can sort of look at where the rat's nests go, what they're supposed to be connected to, and maybe change around how you're doing things. And I'm not going to pay too much attention to a really nice layout, but I will get it roughly here. So maybe we'll put that one there, and that looks like a cute spot for it. I'll just grab this one here and move it over to the other side. Yeah, that doesn't really matter. And what else have we got? The protection. So we'll just grab that. Whoops. Grab that and move that as well and put that here, let's say. Okay, so at this point, you might change the boundaries and squish things together, or you know, decide what kind of a board size you want. And again, you can edit it and change it later. And at this point, I probably don't need the schematic anymore, so I'll just make this larger and zoom in a little bit. And there's a tool for zooming into the whole board. It's also I can control Z or command, or, sorry, control zero or command zero. It's a shortcut, sometimes useful. And if you haven't noticed it already, when you scroll to use the scroll wheel to zoom in, it zooms around as an origin wherever your mouse is pointing. So that's something you have to take into account. It's very useful. But if you want to zoom in the center of the board, you have to sort of put your mouse at the center of the board. Okay, so now I typically get rid of some of the extra stuff here. So I don't usually care about seeing the values or the references or any of the footprint text really while doing routing. It just clutters things up. And at the bottom, there's sort of a summary of what's going on. So there's 5 nets and 9 unrouted. So our goal now is to get this unrouted down to 0. A couple of other things you can have, you can import DXF files to use as board outlines. So if you have fancier outlines that you've generated in some CAD package, you can write a DXF of the outline and import that. You can also use these other tools like the arc tool and so on to rounded corners and things like that if you want to do some of that stuff. I'm just going to have a square edged board because it's simple for now. You can always change it later. And we'll come back to the important topic of mounting tools in a little bit, since I don't have them on this right now. So we might want to neaten this up just a little bit by, you know, getting these roughly even. A couple of other things. At the on the right-hand side, on the bottom, there are a couple of coordinate displays. There's one which is just the sort of XY coordinates of the mouse position, updates as the mouse is moving. There's another one which is a distance one, the DXDY one. And that is from the local origin. And that's pretty useful. And the reason is that you can set the local origin by pointing somewhere and clicking the space bar. Now you see that the DXDY has gone to 0. And so now when I move the mouse, I can see the distances from that point updated live. So if I wanted to position you know, that point exactly 3 centimeters or this point here on the component, 3 centimeters for that, I'd be able to measure it and see what it was as I moved it. There's also a measure tool here, which you can use to measure distances between things. And that's useful as well. Just sort of take measure that you can pull out and plop down. There's also a dimension tool. So if you want to put dimensions on your board layout at the end, for example, for the size of the board, you can put dimensions on with this tool here. So those are some of the general drawing tools for the board layout.
Scott, does Eagle, Eagle has the concept of the command line. Is there anything similar to that in KiCAD?
There's a Python scripting command console that you can get to, and you can do things from that if you know what you're doing with the API. But other than that, no. Uh-huh. The closest thing is the command keys, the shortcuts.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So that's like sort of one letter versions of commands.
Right.
So another thing which I didn't mention before about selecting things, we can click on things to select them. You can also click and drag to select things, and you see it generates a selection box. And so you select everything that's in that box. And there's two different ways that this works. If you start on the left-hand side and drag and click and drag to the right, you'll get one kind of selection, which is it selects everything that's completely enclosed in the selection box. If you do it in the opposite direction from right to left, it'll actually select anything that's at least partially in the box. So you see that it actually selected this, even though the capacitor was only partly in the box. Sometimes that's useful because it makes it easier sometimes to select things without selecting other things that you don't mean to select. And if you're curious, that behavior is directly out of AutoCAD, Autodesk, AutoCAD, which has exactly the same behavior and has for decades. So as I said, a lot of the behavior and interface in KiCAD has it as a pedigree in CAD software of 20 years ago.
I think you said you weren't going to talk about hierarchy, but is there a concept of like persistent grouping? Like, can you, you know, say this is the group I care about every once in a while?
Yeah, sort of. It's not a strong thing at this point, but you can put, I believe that you can group things. I don't use that feature. Yeah, you can. You can group them and ungroup them. So you can put things in a group, yes. I typically don't do it though, so I don't have a lot of experience with it. You can also lock things if you don't want them to move later.
Cool.
Yeah, locking comes in handy sometimes.
Yeah, I do locking, but I typically don't group, although there may be reasons I should. There's probably some use cases I haven't thought of. So that's another way to select things. I typically end up, you might want to group things, I suppose. Although what I typically do is I just sort of grab them with the box and then you can move them all together, for example, if you want to do that. Or you can, I think you can actually, you know, select multiple things with the control.
I think we have to press the shift key, something like that.
Maybe it's shift. Yeah, it's shift, I guess. Yeah, shift.
Yeah.
There you go. So you can do it that way too, manually select a few things. So there's various ways to do it. And so the other thing is sometimes there's ambiguities about what you're pointing to. And so in this case, I'm pointing to the pad, but I might really have wanted to select the whole footprint. And so you can force it to be more lenient in what it's looking at as possible selections by using the Alt key. And so if I do that and click in the same spot, now it gives me the choice of, do you want the pad or the footprint? So sometimes that's a very useful thing to be able to do. The other way to get the footprint, the whole footprint, is sort of click in the middle of it. Sometimes that's not so convenient, and so that Alt key trick is pretty handy.
Is it Alt or Control? Like, I think it, I'm not sure, is it different in version 5?
No.
Okay.
It's all control gives you the context menu. Always has. Yeah.
When, for some reason, in my device, it's giving when I press control and click on the pad, it gives me the option like, do you want to select the pad or the footprint? I don't know. It may be the different. Yeah.
Well, that's very bizarre. Maybe that's, I don't know.
I mean, I'm working with 5. Version 5. It's not version 6. So I don't know whether they have switched it, but their chances are less.
I don't know. I don't know.
I don't see the context menu on Windows 6.0. And when I click Alt, I do notice that if I click Control and click on one of the actual like net connections, it highlights the other connections with the same name. But Alt just selects. It doesn't seem to do anything different for me.
Really?
Yeah, weird.
Interesting. Maybe it's the difference in Windows versus Linux and Mac. I'm not sure.
Yes, that too.
I thought it was the Alt key on all. Anyway. Yeah.
Can anybody hear me?
Yeah.
I can hear you.
Yeah, you're just quiet.
Yeah, feeble. It's.
Thank you.
So Scott, I haven't figured out quite what those little red boundary boxes around all of the surface mount pads are. What is that?
Keep out area, I think.
Keep out for the pad, though? That doesn't make sense, does it?
It's the clearance.
Oh yeah.
For the DRC. I think that's what the red ones are. There's several things going on here.
Yeah.
There's several different things going on. So there's a mezzanine thing, which is a sort of an overall keep out for the component. And then for each pad, this little red line, I think, is the one that is a
clearance, yeah.
Basically a collision for DRC.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it does. I mean, sometimes it screws up. Like if we have like nets that are bigger, and it shows that okay, there is a violation. go ahead, Tim.
That is determined by the design rule. Then it changes with the design rule. Okay, I see. That makes sense.
That's the clearance. That's for this. That's the default clearance because everything's in the default rule.
Okay, gotcha.
But, if it was a different net, it would be, if you had net classes, then the clearance could be different for different types of pads. You'll see the same thing in the, on the traces as well. So let's see, it's after 9. So let's go quickly through some of this. So the X key is the thing to do a route. All the white lines are unconnected pads. So as I do this, I'm sorry, unconnected nets. So as I do this, if I do a right click, you get a menu of various things, including changing the grid. You can change the track posture, which is sort of which way the tracks start out and go. So if I do that again, you'll see that it goes through sort of different layouts. There's a corner mode, which I think makes rounded corners. Is that right? Yeah. So you can do rounded corners by doing that.
That's cool.
And then you can also select the track width. So I can use one of the custom values or even type in a value by using that. So if I wanted to make this a fatter track, I can either select what I'm going to use. Oops, sorry, that's not the right one. Where is it here? Didn't we assign a few? Thought we made a few. No, I didn't get in there. Why not? Didn't I say that? Maybe I didn't say
maybe
that.
Maybe so you hit cancel. Yeah.
Yeah. So let's do that. Let's make a 1 millimeter width. So now I should be able to find that in there. There it is. Okay, so if I wanted to make these fatter, I could select it up there, or I could actually do it on the fly if I wanted as well, or I could use net classes. So I do X, now I get a fat trace. It's actually a little bit too large, but whatever. And we can, you know, we can route these. And if you don't like the way it's going, you can click and freeze a corner. The default behavior on this is that it is a push and shove router. So if I'm coming out here and I'm going in this direction and I need more space, it'll actually automatically push things around for me. It doesn't push components around, but it will push vias and tracks around to make space, which is really handy in many cases.
Is that an option that we need to turn on?
I mean, so you can turn it on when you're routing. It should be by the default, but interactive routing, router settings here is where it happens. And so you can just highlight the collisions. You can do the shove, or you can do what's called walk around, which actually doesn't move things, but moves, it sort of tries to route around collisions.
Okay, awesome.
And there's various other things you can do, like.
Sorry, Scott, where was that?
It's just the right, the context menu while you're doing routing, and then interactive router settings.
Thanks.
It's also under the route menu.
Yeah, I was about to say that.
Right. Yeah, up here as well. So what am I doing? Do this. That's interesting. Oh, okay. It didn't like that. Interesting. Okay. I guess we have to go down a little bit further to terminate that. That's pretty ugly. Let's try that again. Whatever. So we've got it on to zero in a very ugly way. The things that you typically will adjust as you're routing are track widths, the grid. So you probably, this is a 5 mil grid, so this is a pretty fine grid, but you might want to vary it depending on how congested your layout is. If you need to go between layers, go to the bottom layer, you do V.
Yeah.
Which is via, and now, I'm routing on the, and then you click after doing the V to place the via, and that's moved you to the bottom layer, which is in green. Then you can, you know, move around and do whatever you want to do. And you can delete segments if you get out of this. So that segment you can delete with the delete key. A couple of other useful things. If you click on a route, it will by default just select the local segment. If you click the U key, it'll select the rest of that. And then it'll select all of it with a U key one more time. And then if you do delete, it'll unroute it, or at least remove that route. In that case, it doesn't turn into a rat's nest because we had another one. But if I took this, do the U, and then do delete, now it turns back into a rat's nest line near wire. So we can let's see, we talked about adjusting the grid, adjusting the track widths, putting in vias and moving between layers. If I go back here, you see that the colors of the layers can be adjusted if you like. My default red is the top copper and green is the bottom copper. But you can click on these things to change the parameters. Where's that? Is it there? I think it's there.
Somewhere. Scott, do you actually change those? Like I, most of the time I just leave it default.
No, you leave it default. But one of the other things, the reason I'm mentioning it is one of the other things you could do in version 6 that was not in any of the other versions is you can actually change the color of certain nets.
Oh, that's individually. Nice.
And that is handy in some cases because, I mean, it's a feature that all of the fancier board layout programs have, Altium and things like that. Because in some cases, you want different net classes to have different colors. Just makes the layout a lot cleaner, clearer. And so that's a new feature in version 6. And I think it's in the nets here, actually. So you can choose the, yeah.
Oh, nice.
Set the net color in nets here, where you need to highlight the nets, things like that. Okay, so that's that. You can also move by dragging. So the D key will drag. I think it's the, is it the, no, the G key? Yeah, the G key will actually sort of move and interactively route. And move just moves the segment, just disconnects it completely. So the M key does that. The G key keeps things together, but allows you to sort of adjust the routing depending on what part of the thing you point to. And then there's another one too, which is drag, which is the D key. Yeah. Yeah, go ahead, Tim.
I was trying to do that and I was trying to adjust the bend style when I was pulling the track and I couldn't figure out how to do that. Mine likes 45 degrees. Is there a way to
do that? That's because there's a so drag is in 45 degree mode, and then there's a free drag, which is G.
Uh-huh. Okay.
So D and G are two different things.
Okay. All right, that makes sense.
And you can set, I think there's a parameter you can set whether it's 45 or 90 or one and a half or whatever increment you want. What else on this? Let's see here. So you can also edit tracks and change their widths and so on with the E key, just like you can on anything else. If you want to put components on the back, you can flip them. So change side, flip. So that would put that connector on the back side. And now you see that everything's in reverse. What else do we want to talk about? Special tools. So there's a couple of useful ones. There's a move exactly, which allows you to move a component in an exact amount in X and Y. Another one which is useful is move with reference to, which allows you to say, place one component pad or the pad of one component 5 millimeters away from the pad in another component, which is used as reference or any other feature on the board that you want to use as reference. So when you're trying to set things up exactly, those special tools are sometimes nice. There's another one that does create array, so you can array things in regular arrays. And you can position a footprint relative to another footprint. So those are all useful when you're trying to match up measurements, for example, for connectors and things like that with specific places on the board. So those are sort of the general tools. I guess One other thing which doesn't always work, which it was supposed to, is if you want to change the routing of a net and it's already been routed, you notice when I redo this, it actually deletes the old one. That's supposed to consistently happen if you want to reroute something. It doesn't always, for reasons I don't quite understand. So once in a while, it'll leave the old one, and I don't know quite why, but usually a simple way to sort of reroute things is just to redo it, and it'll take away the old one and put in the new one. And also typically, the way that you move initially away from a pad sort of determines how the routing goes. So you see, if I go this way, it starts doing the bend in that direction. But if I start out and go this way, it does the bend in the other direction. So a lot of times to get the routing you want, you sort of start in the right direction from the pad. And once in a while, it makes more sense to go from the one from the other end, and you get a better routing. There's just sort of quirks the auto router.
Scott, is there an obvious way to tell it not to do that delete thing?
I think you can turn it off in the interactive router settings. Where is it?
Yeah, I see. You're right.
Yeah.
Hey, can we flood a ground plane?
Yeah, that was the next thing I was going to do. Before we do that, there's a couple of other useful things. One is so you can select all the various layers here. You can turn them on and turn them off if you want. You can also turn on and off various kinds of objects with this second menu here. And you can select the nets and highlight them or change their colors in this third menu here. Then there's a set of display options where normally both layers. So if I put something on this other layer, so let me do that. So if I do X and then I do B and I go to here. So now I've got something on the back, and sometimes it's nice to sort of only focus on the layer that you're working on. And so if you do this dim thing, I'm on the back layer. And so you see that the back layer is still bright, but the front layer gets dim. And that just sort of declutters things if you're trying to sort out what's on which layer and focus on a particular layer for routing. And then if I go to the front layer, now the back layer is dim. So that's sort of useful. There's a bunch of preset views for different things here, which you can use sometimes. And then the other useful one is this menu at the very bottom here, which selects what your selection actions can refer to. So let's say I wanted to unroute all of these tracks. So I could select the entire thing. And if I selected only the tracks, then when I do delete, let me get back into the selection mode. So now if I do delete, it's gonna unroute everything. So that's sort of like the tear up option in Eagle.
Yeah, I mean, I think they borrowed it from Eagle because it was previously not there in version 5. I don't think it's there.
I think you could still filter what things were. It might not have been in this explicit place. But if I'd done that with everything selected and did the same delete, then I would have been in trouble. So that's a useful thing to be able to do. Sometimes you want to select just the pads or just the tracks or just the vias or something. There are also some global options for editing the tracks and via properties sort of en masse. So this allows you to change all the tracks that match a particular pattern, say to a different width, for example, or the vias. So if you wanted to change the via sizes on a bunch of vias, you could do it with those tools in the edit menu. And there's a few other useful sort of board modification tools here for changing footprints and swapping layers and things like that. So let's go to fill in the plane. So
Scott, one sec. On yep. your objects menu, the one that's next to the layers menu, I played with all of them, but zones doesn't do anything for me. What's a zone?
You had waited 30 seconds? We will answer that question, Tim. Yeah. So that's a flood, a fill or a flood. It's a copper pour, for example. So that's the tool to do it right here. And then you can click on it. It'll pop up a menu and it says what layer do you want it on? So let's say we want it on the back layer. And what net do you want it associated with? So we want ground, let's say, if we want a ground pour. And then you can have thermals or not thermals and the various clearances and other things that you can change about the properties of it. And then you can say, okay. And then you just sort of complete whatever it is that you're gonna draw. So if you wanna cover the entire board with a plane, you don't have to, you can be outside the lines of the board. In fact, it's convenient to do that. And so we'll go back to the end here and close it off. And so typically you just draw it slightly outside and it'll trim the plane to fit the board outline. The reason that's convenient is it gives you a nice place to sort of grab the plane. You can always see it there. So I can always select it by going up here and you can obviously adjust it if you like. So that's now made a ground plane on the bottom. We don't see it yet because we need to fill it. And so the B key fills all of the zones. And you notice that it's some thermals on the ground, for example here. So these spokes are thermal reliefs. And now, Tim, I think if you do zones, you would find that that would disappear.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So, good timing. Just a fraction of a minute early. And so that's how you do ground planes. As you see, it trimmed it to the board size and enforced whatever your clearance rule between the ground pour and the edge of the board is.
Okay, and it looks like it doesn't auto update it, so you have to keep hitting B when you want it to.
You do
reroute.
Yeah, okay. That's an efficiency thing, just because it sometimes can take a while to refill. However, it will not allow you to, for example, run a DRC without reef pouring them if they're out of date.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's true.
Okay, so that's sort of a board. I mean, I wouldn't call a routing good at all, but.
Show them the 3D. It's like, we don't need any additional tool for reviewing 3D.
Yeah, I'm gonna not do that at the moment. So hey, we'll do.
One last thing. I wanna now do some stitching on the ground planes. How do I add ground vias?
So there's a via tool here.
Mm-hmm.
This one right here, freestanding vias. So if you just do that, they will actually be, let's see.
Well, they are ground. That's weird.
They're ground, and the reason they're ground is because that's the first thing it hits when it's drilling through, is that ground plane.
Yes.
If I put it here, it would actually be attached Five-o. To that net.
Oh.
Yeah, okay. That sort of comes in handy.
That's interesting.
The other thing you can do is array these. So you can actually put them in rectangular grids if you want as well. Or you can just, you know, plop them down, whichever you want to do, depending on how you want to stitch things.
Is there a way to automate the stitching? I know lots of tools have that style.
You can array them. So I haven't done this for a while, but I think that what you can do is under special. Let's see here. Special tools, create an array.
That's nice. Yeah.
So that created an array of them.
That's good.
You have to be a little careful, obviously, because it does exactly what you said. So you might have to come back and clean out a few that places you didn't want.
Hmm.
And it's not smart enough to do that, but it will give you like a rectangular array, which sometimes does take a long time.
Yeah, that's true. Otherwise, like you have to manually choose a bigger grid and then do stitch by hand.
Awesome. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. So yeah, that's the way you can do stitching, Andrew, and it also is a handy way to generate vias that attach to nets. Sometimes you can just sort of plop a via down here and then move it.
It's not obvious how you delete a zone.
What didn't delete? Doesn't that work?
Shift work.
Oh, shift work. Did you get that to work? Okay. I just can't for some reason.
Yeah, the easiest place to grab it is out at the edges here. Now it's highlighted, and so I just hit delete and it's gone. Does that not work for you?
Something weird is happening.
Okay.
Maybe you might have just grabbed one edge and you deleted one edge. A line or something.
Yeah. On mine,
something like that.
If I select it and then delete, it deletes the node that I selected and keeps the thing.
Oh, don't select the node because that is exactly what it'll do. Yeah.
Right. But that could be good sometimes.
Yeah. That's what it's intended behavior, and it will be useful occasionally, but that won't be the way you delete the whole plane. That's right. Okay, so that's how you do that. Another thing that's useful to do sometimes is you can duplicate the zones and then move it to a different layer by editing its properties. So if you wanted to have two ground planes, one on top and one on the bottom, you could duplicate this and then change it to the front. It just saves a few clicks sometimes, especially if you're doing multi-layer boards with similar planes.
And duplicate is like copy paste. Is that what you do?
It is Control D.
C? Control D? D. Oh yeah.
Dog.
Oh D. Yeah.
Control okay, D. Gotcha.
And oh, then, so it's the selection filter. If you don't have all items on the selection filter, then
oh yeah. If you don't allow yourself to select zones, then you won't be able to select zones.
Yeah. Right.
That's actually pretty neat.
I had the same trouble with Eagle when I started using Eagle. Like, I was like, why can't I select the layer? I can't select the component. Oh my God.
Okay. So the other thing we can do is there's also a footprint editor, similar sort of thing. So you can generate a footprint with a similar editor to the one we use for the symbol. And you can look at the footprint libraries. So this is the update. There's another place for that. Here's the design rules check. So Tim, here's the thing for test for parity between PCB and schematic. So you can do that if you want. And it will refill all the zones before doing the DRC, unless you tell it not to for some reason.
Cool.
No violations. Yay. Differences between the schematic and the, so that's interesting.
Yeah, mine seems to be throwing warnings about solder mask covering up references, like where a pad is.
Oh yeah, it's going to tell you about those things, and you may or may not care. But yes, some of those things are not electrical problems. They're just appearance problems, like, you know, cutting off a references meter so it would be illegible. Yeah, those are useful to see, depending on where you put things.
So what about these inconsistency things that we're seeing?
Yeah, I don't know what that is, Tim. I'd have to go back and look at that. I'm not sure. I don't think I did anything to cause that.
I didn't notice. Weird.
Yeah, I'll have to look at that. But speaking of things like footprints and stuff, so if we put the references back on, you can move these around just using the M key. Whoops. Let's try that again. So using the M key. So you can, one of the things you want to do generally is sort of put these in places where they won't get messed up by vias or whatever and be legible. So one of the final things you might want to do is go through and make a pass on the, on all of the, there's a case where you might want to put it somewhere else. On all the reference designators, just to put them in good places so that they're legible. And you can also put other text on the boards using this key, this tool here. So if you want to label connectors with, you know, let's try that again. Then, for example, you know, if you wanted to put a label on, you'd put it in the right, put it on the right layer though. So yeah. This is probably going to be on the metal layer at the moment, yeah. The front copper. Yeah. So you would check like this front silk screen, or you can edit it and change the layer that it's on to the front silk, for example. And then obviously that's sort of big, so you'd want to change the size and stuff. Anyway, that's sort of one of the final things you want to do is clean up all that textual information and put other notes on and whatever version information and logos and all the other kind of stuff that you might want to put on to be human readable stuff. Then let's actually get rid of this now and go to a more complete board. So I'm going to just discard all this stuff. So just to cover some of the other things that in a faster way, this is a project, as I said, that somebody by the name of Phil from Phil's lab on YouTube did.
Mm-hmm.
It's a little breakout board.
His tutorials are really good. Yeah.
I'll paste the link in a minute. But this is a schematic, and it shows a couple of useful things. One is that it's organized by sort of function, and they uses some of the drawing keys, drawing tools to, let me get this centered up a little bit, like the line tool and so on to delimit the different things and labels them. And then he uses explicit connections within each of these blocks, but between the blocks, he's using net labels. So these are the net labels that, for example, this spy one clock signal here on pin 11 is also the same as this one here on this connector. So rather than running an explicit line between them, which just makes things messy, you use the net labels to sort of make the connections between the functional blocks. And I think that makes a nicer looking schematic. So that's just using a few of the extra tools. Another thing that he's done, which I didn't bother to show, but which is good practice, is you explicitly put the mounting holes in the schematic. Two reasons for that. One is that in assigning footprints, you can assign footprints to these. So these have been assigned, let's just see, what footprint did he use? He used a M2 mounting hole for that. So you can choose the mounting size holes in with the footprints. So that's sort of handy. The other reason to do it is that if you make changes to your schematic and then update the PCB, if the mounting holes aren't in the schematic, depending on what options you've chosen for importing the changes, it might delete any footprint that isn't in the schematic. And then you'd lose your mounting holes. So it's good to have them in the schematic just because then they never get lost. So not too much else to say here. Just, you know, use the text and the drawing tools to add some additional information here and organize your schematic.
Scott, one thing I noticed about this schematic is that, like those net labels, the font is ugly. Is that something you can change?
I'm not sure whether you can change the font or not, Tim. Let's see. I've never bothered to. No. I don't think so. You can change the like between italic and bold and so on, but that's about it. Oh, it does remind me though, there's a convention for how you specify these things. And so you can get things like superscripts and subscripts. If you click on the syntax help, it'll give you what the conventions are for these labels. A tilde in front gives you a not bar or over the symbol, which is useful when you have negative sent signals. Cool. And sometimes superscripts and subscripts are useful. So that's all that information is in that little help that you get with the syntax help there. I don't know that those labels are the font is controllable, Tim.
Maybe
unless it's somewhere in the other preferences, I don't know.
Yeah, we may have to go there and see.
Okay, so there's that.
Nothing, keep going.
Yeah. Okay, so there's that. Then let's look at the PCB layout that he's done for this board.
Cornered ones.
So one thing that's sort of useful that I didn't mention before is you can change the type of depiction of different features over here on the left. So for example, you might want to change to just outline mode for the zones because sometimes it's hard to see things in the board layout when the zones are filled all the time. So you can flip back and forth by using these over here. And you can do the same thing for tracks and footprints and things as well. You can flip the board view using this menu item here. So now you're looking at the bottom from the bottom. So now the text on the bottom reads in the correct order, which is sometimes useful if you're trying to place labels and things like that, rather than having to read everything backwards as you rep from the top. He's also put a logo on by importing a image file and turning it into a footprint. So this is actually a footprint that he's imported. And he's placed the mounting holes and he's done rounded corners by using the arc tool on the edge cut layer. All useful things. And let's flip back over to the front. Turn off that. What else? 3D viewer is pretty nice. So a lot of the components in the standard libraries have 3D models. You can also add 3D models to things that don't by importing step files. That's where the mention of FreeCAD we were talking about earlier. There's a sort of a nice workflow with FreeCAD to do that, but you can use any other CAD package you want to generate step files. And then they get them put into another set of libraries that are associated with the footprints. So all of these standard components have 3D models already. The connector here that he's using doesn't. And he has a big temperature or humidity sensor, I think it is, pressure sensor, I guess, that goes here, which has a 3D model, but he didn't include it in the in the GitHub repository. So this is available on GitHub. There's a YouTube link, which I will find now and put in the chat. And you can go back and look at that. Where did my chat go? If you want to sort of refresh your memory of what this stuff looks like, there's the link to it. You can watch that. The 3D viewer is nice for a couple of things. One is if you have 3D models for things, you can check the clearances on things and make sure, for example, you can, you know, get your soldering iron into places and get access to everything. And it also is a nice thing to see where the labels are and how they look. And if there are any labels that have gotten cut off by holes or things like that, you can catch that there and make sure your boards just sort of look nice. So those are some useful things that you can do with 3D viewer. You can also export step files and import them for the boards into other CAD packages. So if you need to check like the fit of a case, you can export the step file for the board with the components if they have 3D models and get a step file that you can look at in a 3D CAD package to check whether it fits in an enclosure, for example. Let's see, what else did I want to mention on this? So the last step is fabrication outputs.
Gerber files, yeah.
So you want to generate...
Oh, fabrication?
You want to generate Gerber files for actually getting boards produced. And typically what is selected by default is fine, but if there are some things you don't need, for example, you're milling a board and you don't need the silk screen and the solder mask layers, then you can turn those off. It doesn't really matter, but you can if you don't want them. You only want to have the edge cuts and the front and back copper, obviously. And generally all of the options here are fine. What I usually do is put the Gerbers all into a subdirectory in my project. So if you enter a directory name here, that's where it'll put the Gerbers. So then all you do is hit plot and it'll actually complain to you because this is one place, again, Andrew, coming back to the filling zones, it forces you to make sure that they're correct before you generate the Gerbers, which is nice. So that generates all the Gerbers. You also have to generate a grill file. So you do that here. And again, generally, everything is fine unless you have some special requirements for the type of drill file. And again, it goes into the Gerber subdirectory. So you just generate the drill file. One thing that you might or might not want to do is separate the non-plated and plated through holes. For some processes you might want to do that. So this option you might want to check depending on your production process. That's about it. Everything else generally is fine and the defaults. So then you just close those and that gives you your outputs. So now if we go back to the project folder, where did that go? Yeah. We'll have a Gerber subdirectory here, which has all of the Gerber files. And by default, it uses a sort of a standard naming convention that's very common in the industry. So typically board houses will be fine with this naming convention. You just turn them into a zip file and send them off. So that's pretty much the whole process, I think.
Yeah.
What have I forgotten, Andrew?
But nothing. That was fantastic. Thank you, yeah. Scott. I think that you just covered literally all the important things from the sort of overview. So nailed it. Thank you.
Yeah, it was good.
Yeah. I am going to officially stop the recording. Scott, again, thank you.
And you're welcome.
That was we may have you do this again. Maybe we'll have a intermediate class once we've kind of, you know, gotten into this and learned a little bit more. But again, thank you.
Yeah, I guess one other thing I will mention is that there are plugins, lots of plugins, especially right now for the PCB design thing, which allow you to do cool things. And so you might want to poke around and find some useful ones. And they show up here. For example, there's one for generating cool labels like this, where you have a sort of negative impression of labels.
And those are generally based on the Python interface?
They are.
Yeah, that's great.
Yeah, so there's a lot of cool ones. And yeah, I think that's all.
Cool. Well, it seems very useful, so yay.